The following podcast contains spoilers for the book chosen and may include spoilers for other books in the same series. The participants of this podcast have also been drinking a lot. The participants of this podcast are professionals and did not drive home until sober. Please, drink responsibly.
Read, drink, black out.
I'm trying to read.
Hey, welcome to Blackout Book Club, everybody.
Glad to be here. Thanks for inviting me.
Yep. On today's show, we have Will Spangler, Jacob McDuffie.
What is this intro?
Tristan, well, I just went to a fucking Jack Napier. Welcome to Blackout Book Club.
Welcome.
This is the podcast where we read a book, drink too much, and then try to talk about it. Today's pick was a special guest pick. We had Will do it because he wanted to pick one.
What was your pick, Will?
I picked The Case of Charles Dexter Ward by H.P. Lovecraft.
We need to get some Lovecraftian horror in this. It was bound to happen
at some
point.
So, before we get too far, Will.
Yes.
Why did you get, why did we let Will get a special pick?
Because he was jealous of Ian, because he did one once.
What?
I thought it was because you made him do a shitty book.
Yeah.
Whose book choice was that? It was yours.
Well, I didn't get a guest pick. I had to do the shitty book. So, where's that?
Fair point.
Next guest pick, Tristan Walsh, followed by Tristan Walsh's pick.
Wait a second. I don't like this.
Will.
Yes.
I just introduced you, and then we said your name a lot. Introduce yourself. Do it.
And I'm Will.
There it is. All right. Will. Jacob McDuffie.
Jacob McDuffie.
And I am known as Yogoslaw Ba. Also known as Tristan Walsh.
That's how I read it.
Yeah. Oh, well, we'll go into that. I have a good thing to say. But
it's a thing with a capital T.
Yeah.
So the book that we read
was, as Will said,
Will
the case
said
of Charles Dexter Ward. Like, he already said it.
Yes. I forgot already.
So now that we know about the book, let's talk about the drinks, the other part of the podcast. Boys, what you drinking?
Well, Will has a special drink for us.
Oh, he'll go last.
So
then.
I'll go first.
Yeah, bite that bullet, dum-dum.
Yes. What? No. No.
Drink that beer, dum-dum. Drink that beer, dum-dum.
I don't have a beer. So the book was about people going into the great beyond, reaching into spheres of other realities and treading where other men dare not tread, where they should not tread. So today, for my drink, I will tread where I should not tread.
You made my summary sound like
shit.
That is why I got
table.
A Four Loko.
Oh, damn.
What flavor?
Fruit punch.
Ooh, it looks scary. It's all blood red.
Wait, that's
ooh,
not focused.
Ooh, spooky.
Yeah, so I've never had one. Every time I told someone that's what I'm getting, they were like, "It's a bad idea. Why are you doing that? This sucks." And I'm like, "That's the point, dummy."
I wonder if you'll end up as screamy as I was on Borderlands.
What?
I wonder if you'll end up as screamy as I was on our Borderlands.
No, that's
playthrough.
Just like that's your fault as a human. Right? You scream.
Here's a sippy.
A sippy. Yay. I also can bullshit a reasoning behind my brew.
No, I don't like this at all.
No, I'm sorry.
It's
friend.
A big can too.
Yeah, you have a
it's
lot
strong.
To not like.
Fuck yeah! It's oh my god! It's 12%. I've made a bad choice.
Is it fruit punchy though?
It really punches me.
Punch a flavor.
Not with fruit.
I can bullshit a reason behind my beer too. So I got Samuel Adams Boston Lager because I must be mad to drink Samuel Adams.
Oh, Tristan, you cod.
Papa Lovecraft. I'm nailing these jokes, friends.
I'm just poor this week. I'm drinking PBR.
Cool.
Yeah. Also known as HPBR.
Whoa.
That's a little... All right.
Yeah.
Tristan, wait. Hold on. Wait. Tristan.
Yeah.
I'm honored to work with you.
Thank you. They got you. Put your pencils in the CIA. Son of a bitch.
All right. So, what's our special drink, Will?
That was Predator.
That was a Predator reference.
So, your special drink comes from the depths of the scary place.
Oh, God.
And it is made from the Elder God's blood.
Oh.
It's
it
was supposed to be greener than that, but it's kind of brown.
I like that you lifted it, and the color threw you off, so you went, it's Okay. So here's our drink.
So hold on. That means you did not look at this while you made it. You just grab bottles and hope for the best. That's what you're telling me right now.
The blood of Cthulhu is maddening inducing. You can barely remember a thing.
All right, what's the name of
this? Well, I'm real mad about the color, I'll tell you that.
It's the blood of Cthulhu.
Oh, that's actually what it is?
It's a Macbeth, but there aren't any Lovecraft drinks, so.
Well, that was a pretty fucked up story, too. So, yeah, let's get in.
All right, let's have a smooch.
Let's fucking a smooch.
A smooch. Yeah, I'm going to kiss it. Do we just down it, or?
Live your life, man. You got a Four Loko, so I don't know what you. You pick your poison. I'm gonna sashayed in my, okay, my gullet. It's
better than the Four Loko.
Yeah, it's odd.
Yeah.
What's in that, Will? Give me a rundown of my Cthulhu blood.
You got some whiskey in there.
Makes sense.
We didn't have amaretto, so we used what did we use instead?
Cream de cacao.
You gave me something. What is
creme
it?
Creme de cacao.
Yeah,
I like
that.
How you said creme de cacao, and then you're like, what was that? Creme de cacao. What was that? Cow juice. What was that? He's just going to keep going.
We got some blue curacao. We got some, what is it, sweet and sour mix?
Yeah.
Not sweet and sour mix. Just sour mix.
You got blue cacao.
And we got a little green Kool-Aid for me.
Oh, so you put it in there.
Okay,
yeah.
All right. Probably, it still didn't make it green.
That's probably why it's brown. Anything.
No, it was a lot browner before this, actually.
Cool.
Life is brown. It's just shades of brown. All right, we got drinks. Now we got books. Books! Books! Summary. Yo, Will, you going to summarize some book for me?
I guess if I fucking have to.
You seem real sad about
you.
You
pick the book, you do the summary. Yeah. That's how this works. You've been here, you know.
You've watched me do it.
Badly.
Your turn.
All right. Summary.
Solid start. All right, yeah.
By William Spangler.
Age 9.
Fourth grade.
Underneath the title in his tablet.
Missed Cthulhu's class.
Oh, fucking nailed that joke, Jake.
Yeah.
Charles Dexter Ward, born 1908, was a bright young lad, well-read, well-spoken, an antiquary. He was positively fascinated by anything old.
Give me some of that gross Four Loko on it.
Growing up in Providence, Rhode Island, the city was ripe with
history. It's like a big robot dick filled with liquor.
Go, keep going, Will.
And he would roam the old parts of town, looking at the old buildings and sitch.
Oh, yeah. And sitch?
In sitch, I wrote that.
Yeah.
After many years, however, this became tiresome, and instead, he became more interested in something he found in an old book of town records between two pages mysteriously glued together.
Semen.
Yes. And along with the semen was a record of a great-great-great-grandfather stricken from history by the name of Joseph Kerwin.
Ooh.
And for good reason, too.
Kerwin.
Okay.
Did you pronounce it weird or something?
That's not how I read it. That's
How did you read it? Just curious.
Just Kerwin. I thought I had a better joke lined up. I did not.
Oh, that was a joke.
Yeah, no, see?
Oh,
there it is.
I thought you were just a dum-dum.
Yep, that too.
And for good reason,
I can pull that off.
This guy was fucking weird. First off, he was a complete recluse. I mean,
book
there's
over.
A red flag right
this
there.
This guy was weird. The end.
He never aged. That's also kind of... he would buy all sorts of strange supplies.
Like people.
From the... Thank you, Jacob.
Yeah.
He'd buy all sorts of strange supplies from the apothecary, kept a lot of livestock that were replaced every week. This list is long. Basically, the townspeople...
Well, you're just like H.P. Lovecraft. You got, like, comma after comma after comma.
The townspeople just thought he was an alchemist or something, so they stayed the fuck away from him and his house and his farm. So Kerwin's like, fuck! People getting suspicious and shit. I better start doing some shit to get him off my back, yo.
There's a lot of shit.
So he does, and
he's
then they
do. He's
real
urban.
But then
that's
they
how
don't.
They talked in the 1700s.
Yeah, back in the 1700s.
Shit,
real
yo.
Urban.
These bitches be tripping.
So he donates a bunch of money to the town and gets into the slave trade and he marries some chick and that pisses off this sailor guy, Ezra Whedon, who's like, that 100-year-old weirdo just stole my girl.
He stole his broad and now he's pissed, but no one else cares.
So he goes and gets his buddy.
Did not get that.
Yeah.
And
but
so
her
he goes
dad
and gets his buddy
was mad.
Smith, and they go spy on Kerwin like children for 4 years.
Yep.
Okay. Wait,
was it 4 years?
It was 4 years. God. I like this summary. It's starting to fill in some gaps for me. I was pretty confused most of the story.
It's because it was a poorly written book.
Well, they discover all sorts of shit. Secret nighttime slave deliveries. Secret nighttime mummy deliveries.
Yeah!
A secret labyrinth of tunnels under the farm leading deliveries? To various places. And a nearby riverbank where they also found both animal and human bones. Or how down the river, people reported seeing corpses yelling for help going over a waterfall. And they're like, well, there are graveyards near the river, and we have been getting a lot of rain lately. They said that. That was in the fucking story.
I like how you grabbed your book. You're like, because really?
Really? A lot of this I faded in and out of while I was reading, and I was pretty confused.
I had to write a summary. I was fucking like a hawk.
But if the inhabitants back in 1770, or whatnot are like, yeah, we have a graveyard and like we bury a lot of like undead, and then they get carried away in the rain, they're just like, whoa, waterfall.
After those 4 years, it's autumn 1770, and Whedon finally decides it might be a good idea to tell somebody, so he gathers an extensive paragraph of men, 10 people in all, and they decide to secretly raid the farm and force him to explain himself. And it's here that the journal entries and letters from the people directly involved all sort of end. the raid itself is only described through a neighbor's diary entry who could hear the whole thing happening next door. There was a lot of gunfire, human screaming, inhuman screaming, thunderous voice shouting demonic
and
incantations
some light, right?
So loud that it rattled the windows. You know, the usual.
Yeah.
Post-death.
I feel
farm
like,
life.
I feel like being back in the 1700s, I wouldn't be able to aptly describe such goings on to
I
my
like,
diary.
Like the house is shaking and you hear screams of horror.
Oh no! Human screaming and inhuman screaming.
He's just sitting there with his pipe, just damn neighbors.
Come the next morning, two messengers show up at the neighbor's house asking for rum. They said the affair with Kerwin was over and not to mention it again, and any records or letters regarding his existence were to be destroyed.
What are you laughing at?
You.
Oh, fuck!
Your goopa face.
No!
Finding himself to be even more enthralled in the mystery, Ward heads to Kerwin's hometown of Salem, Massachusetts, where he learns that Kerwin, in his youth, had learned whatever craft he practiced from a man named Simon Orne.
Very spooky.
Who was pretending to be his own son.
We're getting to that. Ward discovers that Orne is one of many collaborators trying to perfect some process.
Jake does, and Jake's just like, I want to be in the book too.
Trying to perfect some process that seems to bring people back from the dead. In a letter, he finds Kerwin's address and decides to visit the home. After some extensive detective work and paint scraping, Ward finds an old portrait of Kerwin, and the resemblance to his great-great-grandfather is uncanny.
Almost identical.
He, like, tells his parents, and his father pays to have it cut out of the wall.
You don't know.
And then behind where the head of the portrait used to be is a little square recess containing some yellow papers
and
a thick, dusty copybook labeled The Journal and Notes of Joseph Kerwin. But he's at the age where you start being reclusive and you don't tell your parents about
and
your
research.
And
you make a podcast
anymore.
And he's like, today on Blackout Book Club, these weird notes I found in a wall.
And you start bringing home books about witchcraft and the occult. And you show a sudden interest in graveyards.
Did you shop at Hot Topic?
Exactly. Well, like any good parents concerned about their son, they call the family physician, Dr. Willett. Dr. Willett's like, he's fine. He's just going through some shit. Don't worry about it. Soon after that, Charles takes a trip to Europe and stays with a baron in Transylvania.
Yep. That happened. Yep.
And nobody, that's pretty much it.
Well, nobody hears shit from him for a while after that.
It's like a year or two, right?
What is it?
And he comes back and then we're just like, you were at Transylvania? And he's like, yeah.
Yeah.
And then we're like,
I had a good time.
What happened?
Yeah, it was whatever. I mean,
scenic.
So he shows up 3 years later at his family's house, but he's acting even weirder, chanting incantations in the middle of the night, and there's weird odors coming from under the attic door.
They really, like,
well, that's
like,
teenagers. I mean,
I know.
They stink.
Like, but, I mean,
but the odors are making the family hallucinate and shit.
We're
going to other planes of existence.
We're going to talk about this.
We're going to talk about a lot of things.
But, yeah, actually, I even wrote, it's like, I tell you, that Transylvanian butt is something else.
I like that you wrote that and then, like, kind of.
You
like,
didn't include
it,
like, you're like, this is just for me.
Yeah.
No one needs to know.
Tee-hee.
Then you shared it anyway.
One night, after some abnormally loud chanting, the family could hear him.
Wait to be sunny.
He wasn't, you can cut to you.
I'll just cut it out entirely. It's fine. What the fuck was that?
Ghosts.
Kerwin?
Cthulhu's! Oh. All over the walls!
What do they look like? We don't know because the book doesn't say.
Keep going. Shouting. The family could hear him talking to a deep, booming voice, and his dad's all like, right, intervention time.
Yep.
And that's when Charles is asked about it, and he gives a fairly rational explanation and apologizes for being a nuisance.
Yeah.
Like a good son.
As we don't get in teenagers nowadays.
So after that, he spends a lot of his time working out of his home.
Jake wants it. It's his precious.
His mother starts
He's
to crack under the pressure.
I hate it, but I love it.
And moves to Atlantic City. He eventually buys his own, like, bungalow to work out of, now apparently has a weirdo colleague named Dr. Allen.
Uh-huh.
He writes a letter to Dr. Willett.
Hold on. He has a beard.
Dr. Allen does have a beard.
Yes,
you know?
this is
glasses.
Go ahead.
Jinx, you owe me Jake's Four Loko. You're not gonna get it.
He writes a letter to Dr. Willett talking about saving the world and being in danger and that they should talk.
Also to shoot Dr. Allen in the face on sight.
That if he sees Dr. Allen, he is to shoot him and dissolve his body in acid.
And to which,
Doc, I need to talk to you right away. But if you see my friend, shoot him in the fucking face and boil him in
acid.
And
Willett goes, crazy teens.
No, he's like, he's perfectly sane. He's not insane. Yeah. He was still sane when he wrote that letter. I guarantee it.
Yeah. Crazy teens.
Which, so, like, after, that's a positive thing I want to talk about.
After he visits Charles' house, he gets a suspicious phone call from Dr. Allen.
Getting, like, oh, I remember I want to talk about things.
Yeah.
A phone call from Dr. Allen prompts Willett to go visit the bungalow himself. I got that much left.
The fuck is all those pictures?
I liked them.
Don't worry about it.
They were good.
All right.
They really brought the story to life.
Charles is there after all and assures the doctor that he had simply overreacted before and that everything would be fine.
Yeah.
Just to give him 6 more months of work.
Yeah, just let me live.
And Willett's like, I don't know about that.
Dr. Willett's like, let me search your house. And
There it is.
Does a quick once through.
Seems like bullshit.
And after
just a rummage.
After he doesn't find anything.
You're full of shit, Charles.
He takes it back to Mr. Ward. That's Charles' dad.
Thomas, I believe.
Yes, I think
they
his
say
name
his name
is
like
Thomas.
One
the
fucking
very
time.
End.
Yeah.
I didn't get his name.
They say it one
letter.
Fucking
and then
time.
I got confused.
Theodore, that
yeah.
was it.
Theodore. Ah, shit, I was close. Yeah. Keep going.
Shortly after, so, just months to work, he takes the information back to Mr. Ward, who decides it's ultimately...
Jake is, like, dying with this Four Loko, but he's drinking a lot of it.
Who ultimately decides that Charles should be, like, summoned and taken to a mental hospital.
I'm feeling it.
Shortly after that...
The spirits? Yeah. Stay tuned for discussion, everybody.
It's gonna be a doozy.
Dr. Willett goes snooping again
C-3PO.
Inside the old bungalow, and he discovers
is this a Star Wars book? Holy shit! Is this canon?
The fuck are you talking
this
about?
This is what happens when you summarize. Everyone else is an asshole.
Welcome to the world of bullshit.
He goes inside the old bungalow and discovers a secret door.
Oh, this is fucked up. Yeah,
leading. To a foul-smelling underground lair.
Yeah, it's a crypt.
Poop.
He finds
shit.
Poop crypt.
Finds all these, like, weird biological abominations locked up for fucking God knows what purpose.
What do they look like, Will?
It doesn't describe them.
Exactly. Keep going.
Oh. Anyway. All these weird jars, like, arranged in a raise, like, filled with some kind of weird blue-green powder, and then he accidentally completes a ritual that Charles had started before, like, leaving.
Oh, shit. What happened?
Will. He blacks out!
Something else happened. There was a figure.
Smoke
monster from Lost.
Yeah, the smoke
rose from the powder that was on the floor, and like he saw a strange figure in there.
Yeah,
right
who was that figure?
118.
118.
Yeah, we don't know who that is.
It's just 118 was the label on the jar.
Yep.
when he wakes up, he's in the.
That sound.
It's a burp. It's a burp.
When he wakes up,
there's a spooky ghost sound. 118 made that. He's like, and then Will's like, oh, I'm passing out.
When he wakes up. He's in the bungalow again, and this briefcase is empty from all the clues he had gathered. The secret door is also missing.
That was weird.
But in his pocket is a note telling him to kill Kerwin at all costs.
His briefcase.
Which was yeah.
His briefcase is empty of all clues. It's like the Scooby-Doo gang's like, oh shit.
Empty your briefcase.
My clues.
To start.
Yeah.
Secret door was also missing. After rummaging through Charles' library again, he has all the info he needs and travels to the asylum to confront Charles with the knowledge. Or should I say, Joseph Kerwin? For the real Charles had been locked away in a cupboard in the library.
He was dead.
By none other than Dr. Allen.
Or should I say Joseph Kerwin?
There's two?
Wait, whoa. When you say locked away, he fucking died.
Yeah. Well,
Kerwin murdered him.
Wait, my question still stands. There was two?
Oh, wait a minute. For Dr. Allen had been the resurrected ancestor the whole time, using a fake beard and glasses to pull a Clark Kent.
Elaborate.
Whoa.
Good one.
Clark Kent, or should I say? I'm kidding.
Kerwin? Was there two?
So remembering his fundamentals of demon magic.
You're faltering.
Dr. Willett.
I'm still confused. I still don't know.
We'll talk about it.
Dr. Willett.
Dr.
Willett reduces the imposter to a pile of blue-green dust.
That.
Mr. Ward is told the truth in a letter, but that there will be an elaborate cover-up so as not to hurt the family name.
Yep.
Damned be the future.
Yep.
Dr. Willett does some follow-up research and finds that all the other collaborators across the globe had been mysteriously killed, thus tying up all loose ends.
That wasn't
That
wasn't in my book.
Hey!
That was our summary
by William Spangler.
That was still a good summary.
That was. Let's go pee-pee and then come back.
We're going to take a pee-pee break. Thanks for watching the summary part. Now watch the discussion part after the beep.
Didn't it become legit magic in the second one?
No. Then it became drums.
What?
Karate Kid 2? There were drums.
The power?
Welcome back.
Welcome back to NPR. Day after Reyes. So,
why
bang.
I'm an NPR
man. That was the book. Now, first question is, we're going to ask this before we get into discussion.
All right.
Yo, do you guys like this book?
Yeah. I find it very enjoyable, honestly.
That's fine. Jake got constipated from your answer, apparently, because he just groaned. Jesus.
I mean, it was certainly dry. I can't say it wasn't.
It is all right.
Yeah? I got real lost.
Really?
Here.
Yeah.
This is
like right up my alley. Thanks.
Well, here. Okay. So I pretty much crushed it these last 2 days.
Yeah.
And I kept fading in and out as I was reading. Got completely lost and then just like finished it for this. So I can't say that I liked it because I feel like if I liked it, I would have understood it.
I see what you're saying. All right.
And I'm not saying it's bad. Wasn't up my alley. Here's my alley. Ain't up.
A lot of names. A lot of weird names.
Yeah. Also, surprisingly, low amount of horrors. Well, where's all my spooky boogies? Where's all my Cthulhu's?
I thought you said whore. It's like a whore.
That too. That's,
but yeah, ladies,
that was a fucking drastic decline in what I expected.
That's a common misconception in Lovecraft literature.
Yeah.
As a general.
Yeah.
It's like
maybe you shouldn't have fucked up so much, Lovecraft.
All the stuff with like Cthulhu and the
Harry
Eldritch
Potter.
Gods, they always play like the backseat to the actual stuff in the story.
Yeah.
They're just like the reason for it, not
you see, it seemed
it's
like
not about them.
I noticed the first thing
what
is
that?
What I noticed.
The first thing you notice is what he noticed first.
I'm an NPR man.
Yeah.
The first thing that I noticed.
Hello, welcome to Blackout Book Club.
Hello.
The podcast where we speak silently.
We're very, very soft.
And I'm Will!
It's like an ASMR.
There it is.
You cocksucker.
And I'm Tristan!
See, the thing I noticed was
that
for every spooky thing, they were like... It was definitely scary. We're not going to tell you why or what it was, but it was definitely scary.
Yeah.
Totes, def, swearsy, circle, that, circle, dot, dot. Yeah. Now you have a cootie shot.
Yeah, that was,
oh, thank God.
That was a lot of the book. Now I understand this was written back in like 1940,
mm-hmm.
where just the mention of spook like scared people. They're like, oh, ghost!
You walk up to someone and go, spooky, and they're like,
oh. Ah! They're like, doot, doot. And then... But the majority of this was just like, and then scary winds and scary urns in a room of coffins. Scary.
And then he saw a creature. It was scary.
Yeah,
it was like some kind of animal or some shit. Will we describe it in any more detail? No. But it made him scream and cry like a goyle, and then he shuddered in the corner.
You don't want to be a shuddering goyle. This is the 1940s.
If we described it to you, you'd be too scared, and I won't tell you.
I feel in a similar fashion to like why they don't ever describe what he completely looks like.
Who, is Kerwin?
Anyone. They don't ever give a description of any of the characters.
Yeah, like they're like dirty blonde.
They say he's like, he has like a sunken face, and that didn't used to be like
that.
I'll
tell you what he does describe everything else in the goddamn book.
H.P.
Lovecraft loves lists. He loves commas, and he likes his sentences to be real long.
Oh, yeah.
Just like his dick.
I didn't know that.
Yeah, well, somebody Googled.
Okay.
H.P. Lovecraft's penis. It was me. It was a bunch of tentacles.
It was an eldritch penis.
Yeah, it was. It was an elder god of dick. The first one where I noticed it like really hard. Let me find it. You talk about something else. All right.
It's supposed to be that classic horror movie aspect of where your imagination is going to come up with something far scarier than they could possibly describe.
Yes.
So they just leave it up to you in a very similar fashion to how they don't describe the main character, so that you can put yourself in the main character's shoes.
I get that. I just immediately recognized that that's what they were doing, but like a little too much.
I did like how they kind of played it off as just the simple like fact that just viewing it, it's a visage that's just so
it's so ghastly that makes you go crazy.
Yeah, it makes you go crazy, and you just like force yourself to forget about it.
Yeah.
Like
no,
that's kind
of
an interesting side of it.
I'm not saying it's not interesting. I'm just saying it wasn't an invigorating read.
Oh, okay.
So I didn't.
I mean, but wait, so you mean to tell me, like, you weren't enthralled when he was, like, crawling around on his hands and knees in that stone room?
Yeah, the aftermath, it was interesting, but, like, the during was, like, and then he looked in the hole, and then there was something. It was maybe part animal or something, and it was super scary.
I will admit, I had to go back
over that 2 times to make sure. I was like, so there was, like, a spooky monster in that hole, right? There was, like, a Silent Hill.
And then he started screaming and backing away, and then he dropped his flashlight, and he was scared.
His electric torch. Because they fucking wrote electric torch for like 6 pages there, and it was just like standing
out.
Excuse me. Because I was like, oh, it's because he's British, I guess, and it's 1940s, he's writing electric torch. And then he wrote flashlight a couple pages later.
Did he write flashlight?
Yeah, and then I was like, no!
I didn't actually notice that at all.
Yeah, I saw that because I wasn't invested, so I was just nitpicking at dumb shit.
Oh,
and
okay.
I was just where am I? Monster? Whatever. Sarcophagus table? Jars? What are we doing? Flashlight!
Say, like Dr. Willett venturing into that dark crypt where he should not have looked and he saw horrors beyond his wildest dreams, I too should not have had a Four Loko. I want to fucking die right now.
Oh,
fuck that thing.
All right, so first, this is all one giant fucking sentence. All
right,
yeah. Bunch of semicolons.
Yep.
Here into the southward, the neighborhood became better, flowering at last into a marvelous group of early mansions. Semicolon. But still the little ancient lanes led off down the precipice to the west, semicolon. Spectral in their decay, where the wicked old waterfront recalls its proud East India days amidst polygot vice and squalor, comma, rotting wharves and bare-eyed ship candeliers and such surviving alley names as packet, bullion, gold, silver, coin, doubloon, sovereign, guilder, dollar, dime, and cent. And I was like, Jesus Christ! Next sentence. I was like, what a list! Next sentence. Sometimes as he grew taller and more adventurous, young Ward would venture down in the maelstrom of tottering houses, broken transoms, bubbling steps, twisted baldrums, sweaty faces, nameless odors, winding from the South Maria corridors. I'm like, whoa, list guy! Calm down! That does not take place of descriptions by just listing things.
Now that I think about it, you're right. There was a lot of filler in the beginning.
Yeah. And it happened, it was a lot in the beginning. And that's probably why I started drifting off, like, more.
Yeah.
Like, I don't have the page, but I remember vividly at one point, he's like, and he stared off into the sunset with its beautiful reds and sparkling golds and lovely purples and strange greens. Like, too many colors!
Oh, like, I don't even...
What are you doing?
I don't know if you realize, my entire summary skipped the entire prologue.
Oh, sounds great.
It's like, it was just like, he escapes from the asylum, but you know that later, so...
Yeah! I know
that's the draw, and that's supposed to, like, get you reading, because they, like, they lay it all out, and they're like, and how did he do this, and what was he involved in, what did Dr. Willett know?
Was something I did, like, in the beginning, where it was like, Dr. Willett went and had a meeting with him, and then Charles Ward mysteriously escaped, and then as it went on, it was like, and no one believed, like, any of the stuff, and there was the alienist, which is a fucking psychiatrist, because they're old-timey.
Whoa, alienist is psychiatrist?
Essentially.
Oh, I actually didn't know that.
No, I thought alienists were people who believed in Cthulhu's.
Nope. Oh, I thought alienists...
I thought they were spooky boogie monster people.
I thought alienists were just like radical thinkers.
No, they were psychiatrists at the hospital.
Oh, okay. Because I knew there were two of them.
Yeah, and like as like that they came in, they're like, this dude's crazy. And Willett was like, he's definitely like dealing with like dark arts and shit. But then Willett just like, for like... It like, the book was presented as like some sort of like public written document. Almost, I guess,
yeah,
at parts
like an
where, like,
report.
Yeah, like Dr. Willett was like pretending like he was just like, hey, he's not crazy yet. He's still like acting normal here. Where
so
he,
I can look at him
like,
some more.
Yeah, like Dr. Willett was just like, he's fucking dealing with black magic bullshit. Yeah. And he was like, it's definitely real, but he's not going to tell anyone because no one's going to fucking believe it. And it was like, when he went to go like meet with him, he was just, he wrote a letter to his father. It was just like, I'm going to, like, everything's going to be square. You're never going to see your son again. I'm going to call you and tell you he's escaped. But you don't worry, he's right. In a safe place. And it's like Willett knows everything that's going on. He's the guy that knows.
And
the
he's
shit
the, well,
that's
he's
happening.
Also he also becomes a primary protagonist.
Yeah,
in the
when
story.
He, basically when he like goes to the crypt, I think.
Yeah.
Is when it happens. And like
which
yeah.
is chapter which is the fifth.
It's
that's
pretty
the
late.
Final chapter,
it's pretty
yeah.
late, yeah.
Which is like the whole thing's like five chapters.
It's five chapters.
Divided into
Yeah, they're
like,
divided into sub chapters
yeah,
that are like
weird.
Five,
and,
six,
and,
or seven.
And it gets to the end where he goes to talk to quote unquote Charles
yeah.
Ward.
But
what
ain't Charles?
But he's like, I know who you're, Joseph Corwin, fuck you. I'm gonna banish you. But it's still like, and then it gets like it ends at where it begins, and it's like that whole like cool thing where it's like, oh, Willett really knew a whole lot more than we knew at the very beginning where
right.
it led on. That was cool.
So were there two Corwin though?
No.
What?
He was okay, here's what happened,
oh.
Tristan.
So he was Alan with a beard.
Yeah.
But he
yes.
was also
hang on, hang on,
a painting.
Back up before
Will,
that.
You got this.
Before that.
Well, Jake picks his nose.
So, so okay, this is what I can gather, because it also never explains why he digs up the body of Ezra Whedon, either. And I think...
Well, because she was his bitch wife, and he's like,
no,
yeah,
Ezra Whedon
it.
Is the guy who is like... Oh, well, yeah, all right, see what you're saying. Never mind. I thought you were saying he was a woman. But, I think he digs up Ezra to find the grave of Kerwin when he can't find it otherwise.
Yeah.
And then he uses that information to resurrect Kerwin, and then they needed to hide him because they look exactly the same.
Okay.
So at first, he's just playing an imposter, and they just, like, keeps one hidden, and while, like, one plays the part of Charles.
Right.
And then they decide this is too much of a pain in the ass, so they get Joseph Kerwin a disguise, the beard and the glasses, and he becomes his assistant.
Alan.
Yeah, it becomes Dr. Alan.
But he has to get killed. He has to be moided.
Yeah, but then Charles Darwin realizes what?
Charles Darwin! He realizes that he evolved past an eating Alan.
Never, someone else go. I'm embarrassed.
I
and Kerwin's finches had evolved.
I want to bring this up. All right, so the painting, clear allusions to like Dorian Gray.
Yeah.
Not only that, in the book.
What's Dorian Gray?
The tale of Dorian Gray where the painting ages instead of him.
But if he ever looks at it, all the age
will transfer onto him. So he can live forever.
Okay.
As
long, but he
ever
he never
story?
Sees. No, I've never heard that.
Oh, it's a very famous writing by Oscar Wilde.
Ooh,
oh.
He knew the name and everything.
Was named in the book.
Oh.
Page 66 in Jake's, anyway. From the time the obliteration of Kerwin's memory became increasingly rigid, this is the flashback to Kerwin hanging out in his poor town and shit, extended by the last common consent, even to the town records and files of the Gazette. It can be compared in spirit only to the hush that lay on Oscar Wilde's name for a decade after his disgrace, and in extent only to the fate of the sinful king of Rusnar in Lord Dunsay's tale, whom the gods decide must not only cease to be, but must cease ever to have been. So I don't know that next dude. Fuck him. But Oscar Wilde wrote Dorian Gray, painting, who took all the fucking magic aging, and Curran, just a fucking painting man.
Yeah.
Who was also a mortal man.
Yeah. Clear weird allusions to it, which, and then I had to look this up, Dorian Gray came out 50 years prior to this story.
Okay.
So, like, did he throw that in there? It's just like a, I was inspired by this, suck a dick.
Maybe.
Like, clear.
Well, I mean, you know that Lovecraft didn't even publish this in his lifetime, right?
No,
I didn't know that.
Oh yeah, it was like it was something that was dug up from his old records, and like they just
it was in his grave next to the other grave.
So he was...
they found an old portrait of Lovecraft, and behind the portrait,
there it was.
So he just liked the right, and then no one cared, and then he died, and then people cared.
Well, people still
what?
Don't really
no,
care.
They cared about his work, but he felt that this wasn't good enough, so he never published it.
Oh,
oh,
that explains a lot. Yeah.
So I thought that whole Oscar Wilde thing was, again, like, I got super confused, like, the whole story.
Mm-hmm.
Between the lists, just fading in and out. I got the gist of it. I knew, like, Kerwin was, you know, the descendant. The ancestor. Yeah, and then, like, they looked exactly the same in the painting, and then, like, well, what was his name? Whitney? Who was the doctor?
Ezra?
Oh, Willett. Yeah. He became, Whitney. Like, the protagonist, and he was like, I know more than I know, but I want to know even more than what I know.
Can you say props to Detective Dr. Willett?
Yeah.
Like, where the fuck did he, like, get this in, like...
Yeah.
He got real brave, too.
Yeah, not only
brave... He's just like, oh, spooky catacombs? Oh, I gotta go by myself now? Dad's sick? All right, get out of here,
and
Dad.
And he solved a mystery that nobody could solve for like 1,000 years.
Yeah. Willett's got this on lock.
Yeah.
John Lock.
And he's got...
Lost. We're John back.
Again. And he got it, and he's just like, everything is okay. I figured it out. Oh, I read this incantation like backwards or whatever, and it totally defeats you. Suck a dick, dragon tail.
Yeah.
And he's just like, no, you defeated me.
He turned to dust.
Yeah, like a fucking 80s cartoon.
The Elder Gods must be like really lenient for pronunciation keys.
Definitely.
Or something.
Oh, that was the thing I wanted to bring up.
What?
Okay.
The woman that remembered it and wrote it down?
No, even better. Dumb pronunciations. So I get to this page. Which has like the cool dragon tail symbol.
I didn't have
symbols.
Oh,
no.
Yeah,
mine's
special,
just text.
Special me.
Special edition.
So, I get to this dragon tail page. It has the little symbols and it has like the writing underneath.
Yeah.
Of course, me, I don't only just do the podcast drunk, I read the book drunk sometimes because I have a problem. So, I get to this and here's the sentence beforehand. Dragon's tail or descending node. The appearance of the hole was something like this, and almost unconsciously, the doctor realized that the second half was no more than the first, written syllabically backwards, with the exception of, and then it cut off, but I instantly had to go to the fucking image. This is how I read it.
That's exactly how I read it.
And then I just went, nailed it, and like nodded in approval. So Leah gets home from work, and I go, all right, so you like Cthulhu and all that shit, right? Let me know how my pronunciation is on this, right? Jewish. And then it's dragon's head, so it's a little upside down thing, and she's like, what? And she looks at it, and then she starts to read it, and I just hear her go, yeah, to which I liked even more, because that last "uah," which is just "uaah," made me think of the sound people make in Street Fighter 2 when they get beat and they go
I think they described it as like a crescendo, so it gets louder at the
end. Yeah, so it gets crescendo, like when you beat Guile, and then it goes it's going up. It's crescendo. I like mine better.
It was funny, Tristan. I appreciate it.
Oh, and then the other one, it also says that they're like the same thing, but it's like backwards. And I was like, yine, again, again, okay. And then the other one's Agrod Eif. And I was like, that's not backwards.
Yeah, I was wondering that same fucking thing. I didn't quite get that either.
I was like, this is not backwards.
No, I do have to, I would like to ask. Both of you.
What's that?
Anyone else listening out there in the YouTube world?
I don't think they can answer.
Hey, there he is. Very, very early on, when they talked about how similar Charles Dexter Ward looked to Joseph Kerwin, it's like, it is almost, they could be identical twins. It's so close. It's crazy. I immediately went, he is going to doppelganger the shit out of this guy.
Oh, yeah. Undoubtedly.
This is obvious as fuck all.
Yeah.
And in the very, like, page fucking 2, that early, I think it was, when they were talking about Dexter Ward in the hospital, where he was asking people about things that were happening in current times, but he had knowledge of past times, and he just seemed off. Immediately, I'm like, that's not Charles. That's fucking somebody else. This is all, like, I knew that early. The foreshadow, like, it just seemed too easy to figure out how the end would be to me.
To me? Not in the slightest.
Ah!
Did not pick that up at all. When the painting was the same, I thought he was gonna be the same dude and go, what, I'm the same dude?
Yeah,
whoa!
I thought it was like...
and like totally blow his own mind. And be like, oh, I know all this old shit. Also like elder gods and magic. Wow.
See, I thought like Kerwin had used some sort of magic spell to make sure that he would be reincarnated.
That's
something.
An interesting way that it could have gone. Yeah.
That's the way I
oh,
thought
Oh, mine
it was
wasn't interesting?
You said it was essentially the
Fuck
same
you,
thing.
Tristan.
Except you just went,
I worded it
better. That's what
no,
you did.
No, I thought... You said doppelganger.
Yeah.
I didn't think doppelganger. I thought he was the same dude. Like, verbatim same dude.
Simulacra.
And then he just didn't remember he was the same
like he,
dude.
Well, that's what Will just said. Reincarnation. But he didn't
so
know.
So then mine was good. Then.
Yeah. But you
yeah.
But you did not say it good.
That was ironic.
I think we need to take a break. I'm...
Oh, are we done with discussion?
I'm
I finally
upset.
Don't
want
to... I don't want to die anymore, so...
I'm real
That's
upset
good.
About this whole...
I did find the little article where it says that the other two people died.
Oh,
yeah!
Yeah!
Live your life!
Fucking the thing with fucking Willett where he accidentally resurrected somebody.
Yeah,
and then he was like, oh no! Passed out, woke up the next day. What happened? We don't know.
Oh yeah, what's the 118?
Nobody
knows.
No one knows. He's gonna go kill everyone?
It said it was Kerwin's like
Shrug.
Enemy though.
Yeah, but who?
Yeah.
Ooh, yeah.
Shrug. So is it the sea captain who's mad?
But at the same time, he said,
yeah, I don't know.
He said it was
anybody?
His enemy.
Was it Einstein? Because at one point in the book, they were like, Kerwin's smart, Einstein, suck a dick, Einstein.
But Kerwin,
who knows?
But
I don't.
Kerwin was in the
no
process
one.
Of bringing him back anyway. So why would he bring back the one person who could stop him?
Because he needed a foil to end the book.
Oh, and on that note.
Oh, better question. What do you think the spooky monster in the well looked like? Because
oh, okay.
I imagine the shitty homunculi from Full Metal Alchemist.
I don't know what that
like
is.
The half man, half dog thing?
Yeah, the dude made out of his daughter?
Yeah.
I was like, that's what it looks like, because he was trying to make a Philosopher's Stone, which I thought for like a lot of this book.
Because it...
Oh, that would make a lot of
specifically,
sense.
Specifically, one thing it did specifically mention is that it looked partially not quite humanoid, but it said the proportions were all wrong.
Yeah.
So I pictured something kind of akin to, like, the Charger from Left 4 Dead, where it has, like, a giant, like, arm or something, or maybe it has, like bones jutting out in all weird fucking
and
directions.
He's lying around a hole like, hey, fuck you, dude. I've been here for 170 years, suck a dick.
I've been standing up in a well for fucking on hundreds of years.
Every day is leg day. He's exasperated at this point.
I get it. I imagined sort of like Gollum from Lord of the Rings,
yeah,
but a lot darker skin tone and just like maybe some horns and a little lankier. And
someone's gotta have fucking horns.
Maybe,
it's a demon.
Yeah.
And on that note, let's take a nap.
Sounds good. Welcome back.
It's Blackout Book Club, and this is fan fiction.
I'm a fan, I have to say.
We read the book, but like
we
felt like there were some parts that needed to be altered in some way, shape, or
mostly
form.
The ending.
Yeah, that happens quite often.
Almost every single time.
Endings.
It will. Anyway.
This is your book. You want to take it away? You want to give us your fan fiction?
Sure.
Did you do an alternate take on the story or ending? What'd you do? Sequel?
What'd you do, a sequel?
Well, actually...
my good job repeating me. Fucking
my fan
no
fiction's
problem.
A lot more half-assed than that.
Excelente.
Instead of like a single fleshed out idea, I just have a bunch of really flimsy ones.
I
I'm
like
gonna
it.
Throw at you rapid fire.
Okay. Lightning
what?
Round! Lightning round! I like it.
Alright.
It's his episode.
You ready? You ready?
Yeah.
A sequel where Dr. Willett can't get it off his mind. What happened? And so he becomes an adventurer, traveling the world to stop all other necromancers with the help of his trusty sidekick, the unknown 118.
Johannes Cabal with numbers. Got it. Keep going.
Sweet.
Or an alternate ending
or...
where Willett finds the catacombs and One Punch Man shows up and destroys the whole place. What?
Yeah, that's a good one too. I like the crossover. We don't have a lot of old English writers crossover with
it's
modern...
It's not rapid enough. Or...
modern... anime.
Or like a sequel.
Yes,
a
yes.
sequel where Kerwin comes back and raises his army of the dead due to Willett's shitty disposal techniques.
Oh, yeah.
That, or the best one of all, and this is ready, knowing my hatred of Thunderbolt Kid and the fucking memoir, I want to see the memoirs of that manservant who presumably didn't know anything that was going on in that entire
that
mansion.
That Spanish guy?
Yeah, the Spanish guy.
Yeah, what was the Spanish guy?
I want to know his story.
What is happening?
Like the whole story, that just from his perspective? That was
the
bad.
Whole story, just from his perspective.
The same.
I heard another loud noise. I took a shot of tequila. I didn't worry about it.
That was not Spanish.
They don't pay me, I say.
Jake, if you had to vote on one of those ideas, which one would you pick?
I would say the one with the Spanish man.
Yeah, that's solid choice. I'm really into One Punch Man right now, so...
He just keeps on ending things in min.
Yeah. He... It potek min.
Oh!
It's a character from Guilty Gear. I was making fun of you. You guys didn't get that?
Not at all.
You guys don't play Guilty Gear?
What the Which fuck one's Guilty Gear?
It's a 2D fighter. It looks real sharp.
Oh, okay, cool.
It's not Blaze Blue.
That's the one with the tanks, right?
Which
no, it's not.
Is that
it's
armored?
People.
Is that armored core?
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's armored core. Have you played Guilty Gear Armored Core? It's a good game.
I played.
Jake, are you going or am I going?
I played.
Oh, God, get off this fucking train.
I played
Jeez.
Armored Core 6 for the PS2, I think.
Anyway,
it was pretty
Jake,
fun.
Are you going or am I,
I
going?
Had tank treads for my guy.
Summary or sequel?
Oh.
Tank treads made you heavier.
Well, you're clearing space for an arm wrestle contest.
One of us so has to go.
There's only one way to find out. So
who has the stronger?
For I guess for the audio ending. Podcast, we'll just have to clip to the very end of this arm wrestle contest.
No, for
won't
the
be
audio podcast, we'll just describe
okay.
the arm wrestle
Will,
as it happens.
Will, you have to do the hand. You have to put. Yeah. Oh, you know.
Yeah,
you
I'm
fucking know.
I fucking.
He's, all right. He's choreographed an arm wrestle.
And get it on.
None of us started. Neither of us were like, yeah, we're arm wrestling now. We both just hung out for like 3 years. Look at this kid crooking his wrist.
Look at this kid bending his pop filter.
Oh,
no, I don't like pop filters.
Tristan's a strong man. No!
I did push-ups today.
No!
Wait, does that mean I go last?
I don't know. It means you get a choice. It means you get a pick.
You go first.
All right.
So I can, like, save the bomb garbage for last.
Like Toby determined.
I need to work out again.
Hey, you could do... I did 15 push-ups today, and I did 16 after that.
Oh, man.
That's 31.
You know how many I did today? Zero.
Oh, that's okay. You, like,
it's fine.
Got lunch.
Booze.
I missed lunch.
I went to a barbecue place I'd never been to before.
Sonny's?
No, it was called... Barbecue?
I've been there.
Really?
Yeah. They have one in Brandon. It's good.
It's where I win.
Yeah. Wow. It's good.
Remember when the show had a format?
No. No, I don't.
Okay.
Welcome to Barbecue Talk.
Mine is...
Barbecue's pretty good.
My fan fiction is an alternate ending.
But besides okay. that, though, barbecue story real quick. One time I went to barbecue with the ex-relationship of mine, and then we had delicious barbecue, and then went home and I got a blowjob, and that was a great day.
That sounds,
continue.
That sounds like a nice day. Nice evening.
What?
Yeah.
There's a lot of bees in that day.
I had brisket and a cheddar sandwich. It was very good. They have many sauces.
You said this was an ending.
It was an alternate ending. All right. Mine starts at when Dr. Willett is in the catacombs, in the
Ooh,
crypts.
Spooky.
He's in there searching around. He finds all the jars, the guards, and the materia.
Right. Yeah.
He gets into the torture chamber.
Which sounds like it's from Final Fantasy.
It's exactly what
it's
I
Latin,
thought of. We should
okay.
have talked about it in the discussion, but we didn't.
Now
here we are.
Catacombs.
He goes into the... The torture chamber, 118 is there. He starts reading shit on the wall. He reads it aloud because he's a fucking dumbass.
Yeah.
He reads the incantation. Spooky clouds going up. Oh, what's that shape in the clouds? Dr. Q. I fucked up. Dr. Willett, he accidentally reads the incantation. I already said that.
Doing good, Jake.
So, Dr. Willett, up to this point, he theorized that what the materia was the greatest minds of history... That Joseph Curwens and other men of his like
yeah.
right.
were trying to resurrect to gain their knowledge and right. become gods of men, basically.
Yeah. This... Einstein, Hawking, Hitler.
Exactly.
Hitler. But as Hawking wouldn't be around that time period. Jesus.
But he was actually what Curwens and those men were trying to get were the greatest gams in history.
Oh, they Sorry. Were gonna make some legs.
Helen of Troy, Nefertiti, Sacagawea, Joan of Arc, Marie Antoinette, Queen Elizabeth I, just to name a few. 118 was Cleopatra, the finest of them all.
I know for a fact she had some gams. I've seen hieroglyphics.
This was not a crypt into the great beyond. Just a smut dungeon. Just dirty old perverts fucking.
The title of The Case of Charles Dexter Ward's Smut Dungeon sounds awesome. Oh, man.
He was in a torture chamber. Not torture, but BDSM.
Not torture. Just BDSM.
It was Kerwin. Wanted. This was still a perversion of morality and humanity. Yeah. Kerwin must be stopped. But first, Cleopatra was looking mighty fine in that sex dungeon. Dr. Willett totally had a boner. Basically, the rest of the ending is just 50 Shades of Grey at this point.
Oh.
And okay. I won't go into graphic detail. There's penetration.
Wait, so the first three-fourths of the book is a horror thriller story.
Yes.
And the last quarter is just a fucking smut book.
Yes.
It's just erotica.
They just fuck a lot.
All right. Yeah. It would have been good payoff. And I can only imagine the way that H.P. Lovecraft would write it, too. Because it'd have all the commas, and it'd just be a big list. And then he proceeded to touch her titties and butt and pooper and legs and cans and vagina and hair and nipple and nose and eyes and licked her clit real good. Semicolon. All the way down, down, down.
Like,
woo!
She left me a letter the following morning. It read, "When ye hath separated, all hath from that which has been called from the oldest spheres to thine..."
Yep. I'm horny already, Will. You're nailing it. You're fucking nailing it. You gotta put the word butts in there, and then people will fucking read it.
My only goal was to get
capital B butts.
My only goal was to get a laugh, and I got it, so I think I succeeded.
Maybe two or three.
Was that confusing to anyone else how, like, every word during those letters were capitalized?
Mm-hmm. They're just like, they're all important. Every single word.
Every word I write is important, don't you understand? Yeah, I am Harry Potter Lovecraft.
Damn it, that was a little of my alternate endings. He just opens the cupboard and Dr. Allen's there and he's like, "You're a wizard, Charles."
He's dead.
It's a delusion.
You're a necromancer, Charles. Alright.
Yeah. Alright, whose turn is it now?
I found the actual ending for the book. It was buried behind a painting.
Whoa!
In a wall. It looked just like me. The painting.
Oh!
I'm sorry, the wall. The wall looked just like me.
Well, that's craziness.
Very similar to it.
Spooky.
I'll continue. I believe you'll recognize these sentences. "There had, as had predicted, been no need for acids. For like his accursed picture a year before, Joseph Kerwin now lay scattered on the floor as a thin coating of fine bluish-gray dust, which Willett carefully collects off of the floor. He delicately places the remains in a small patch of wood cellulose that's been mixed with agar. The concoction is tightly wound, placed before his lips and set ablaze. Will its lungs fill with the residue of a potentially cosmic being, making him also immortal now, maybe? Is that how this works? Was Kerwin a Cthulhu? Did we accidentally read Dorian Gray? Honestly, I'm a little confused with the whole situation. Could you just take..."
Okay.
Maybe we should just take a step back, pop on some Floyd, and just kind of try to figure some stuff out, man.
Figure out the mysteries of life and whatnot.
The end.
What?
It was all weed all along.
So he smoked. He smoked Joseph
him
Kerwin.
And maybe got powers. I was a little confused. I would have elaborated in the ending that I found in the wall. But, like, I didn't really know what Kerwin's deal was. So, like, if you smoked his weird blue-gray ashes, what happens?
It's cash. You need to pack a new one.
Yeah, probably.
Yeah, you need to pack a new ancestor. Yeah,
that's old shit, too. You know, that's been around a long time. It's not going to get you a good high.
It's that Salem doo-doo brown, man.
Ew. It's poopy.
He's like... He like packs the fucking, and he's like, "Oh, fucking stem, finger." What? Get this shit out of here. Yeah. So in the true ending that H.P. Lovecraft, again, this wasn't published for a long time. So yeah, he smokes the shit out of it. And then becomes maybe a cosmic being. Also says we should listen to Pink Floyd, which wasn't around in 1940, but maybe he saw some fucking magic time travel.
Yeah,
shit.
Like they saw through time and shit, yeah, like dude. In BioShock Infinite. Yeah. I get you.
Also, was Kerwin a Cthulhu?
No, he was just a necromancer.
Okay.
Cthulhu was an elder god.
I didn't ask that question. The book did. In this ending.
This book doesn't really delve...
He's the offspring of Yogg-Sothoth.
Yogg-Laga. This book doesn't really
delve... Just sounds like you're sucking balls.
Yogg-Sothoth.
Yep. Yogg-Sothoth. Balls.
This book doesn't really...
What a joke, ladies and gentlemen.
You did it. You pulled it back. Your ending was garbage, but you really pulled it around.
Oh, he noticed.
Yeah, no fucking shit. All of us noticed.
I told you it wasn't good.
No, it wasn't. Why were you the anchor?
I was the only one who wrote mine.
What do you mean? You were the only one.
You guys took a nap, and then before the podcast, you're like, oh, shit, endings.
Yeah, and ours were better.
Okay, my turn again. Alternate ending. Uh-huh. The guys hang out with some animes. Alternate ending. The guys hang out with animes win butts. You got alternate ending. The guys smoke weed with butt anime. Whoa! This is Blackout Book Club.
Wait, Will, what was your ending again?
One of them.
That's right. Okay. Yeah. So we basically kind of hit everything. Like,
yeah. Like
funny sex stuff, funny drug stuff, and then like literally everything else.
Yeah. Well, then I hit all of them. I hit the funny sex drug anime stuff. That's the niche that we needed.
The Nietzsche. Nietzsche.
Yeah, the Frederick Nietzsche. He was a Renaissance painter. Painted a portrait of Kerwin, and he was like, there you go, nailed it. You can get a little scar above your eye.
And he hung out with Assassin's Creed.
Yep. I didn't play Assassin's Creed. Hey, this was the podcast.
Did you enjoy it? I didn't.
Book club.
The end of the podcast.
The end. Thanks
for joining us.
What are we reading
next
week, guys?
That's not the music, Tristan.
No, it's not. But you know what is the music?
What?
Shut up. It's my pick. Next is my pick.
Tristan.
Hey, Tristan's pick. You know what I'm going to do?
What's our next book?
I'm picking Wise Guy.
Wise Guy.
Wise Guy, Life in a Mafia Family.
Singular.
It sounds familiar.
It was by reporter Nicholas Pileggi. I can't pronounce Italian names correctly, but it is what the movie Goodfellas was based off of.
Oh. You're stealing my shtick.
Yeah, here's your shtick. My dick, your shtick.
What? No, stop fucking it. Stop fucking my shtick. No, stop it. Stop it. No, no, no. No, he's eating my shtick. He's Frankensteining my shtick. Stop it. No.
I'm horrified, but I can't look away.
Yeah, it's like sex is a train wreck with me.
So. Sex is like a Lovecraft monster.
Yeah. It drives you mad.
You literally have no idea what it looks like or what happened, but it's spooky.
Yeah.
That's all you know.
Am I a Cthulhu?
Maybe. We don't know. I can see you, so probably not.
Anyway, I'm picking Wise Guy because I want a biography that isn't shit. And I want some crime that isn't sneaky people that did not pan
you
out
thought, you
as
thought
crime.
You'd picked, you thought you picked too
spooky.
Oh my
god, dude!
I'm embarrassed.
Joke of the night, everybody. Joke of the night.
You already said the thing. I just wanted to reiterate,
I wanted to nail two things that I did not nail so well. Also, I could pick movie books, Jake, so suck it.
But that's my thing.
Yeah, I can take people's things. Hey, Will, is that your beer? My beer now?
No!
I need that for toasting. You can have it back. Well, you gotta run it with me, like, putting hands on. Stop, it's mine now. Wait, there it is. Hey, so...
Thanks for listening.
If you like the podcast... Like, subscribe, tell your friends, tell your grandmama, tell some wise guys about the next one. And, hey, Will, you want to lead us out on a cheers?
Please, please review us on iTunes. It helps a whole lot. It costs you literally $0 to do, just like a minute of your time.
Yeah, give us a review and just talk about...
Just search Blackout Book Club. It's pretty easy to find. We're like the first thing.
Hey, if
that's
you,
why we named it that. It's different. SEO optimization.
If you write a positive 5-star review
and just talk
read it.
Just talk about how much you like Jake's face. I'll PayPal you $2. I'll do it.
Well, don't just promise money.
Well, I'll do it.
I mean, yeah. I am taken, ladies and gentlemen. I don't want to, like...
Options on the table. Here's the table. Here's the option. Bye!
But wait, no, no, cheers! Don't turn it off!
Forever!
What is it? What's our cheers?
To living forever!
Yeah!
Dorian Gray!
And resurrecting your dead ancestors!
Still Dorian Gray!
And
Dorian
becoming Gray. A god!
Probably.
Dorian Gray. It's a Dorian Gray.
Yeah.